I'm going to show a few miscellaneous slides as I wind things down. So drug products and formulations, although not the topic or highlight of this presentation, I'd like to mention that the general principles for drug products are similar to that for drug substances. But there are some other avenues you have to address, like excipient drug interactions, and that's often done by performing excipient compatibility studies, mixing API with the excipient that you think you're going to put into your formulation or with the sum total formulation and look for the absence or presence of degradation products. One would also like to ferret out what is truly drug substance alone mediated versus what is formed through interaction with an excipient. And the easy way to do that is your control is simply drug substance alone without excipient. This kind of study is actually even done for toxicology support. In the world of preclinical, most of the oral formulations are some kind of detergent like tween. I hate calling it a detergent, but it's a, and some kind of viscosity enhancer. And in other feeding regimens, it's like a diet admixture or solid mixture of rat chow with drug. And one should do in advance of that compatibility studies to see what might happen, because people would like to change the cage food as least as possible and not have a stability issue confound the study that you're doing for tox. Parenterals, of course, are typically in vials, and one needs to acknowledge that container closures can be an issue for stability because they can interact with your drug substance. They could leach or they could be extracted. By the way, leachables are what naturally comes out. Extractables are when you force the situation, so to speak, with perhaps accelerated conditions. This is my miscellaneous slide, which I wanted to say, when you're thinking about stability, don't limit ourselves to just chromatograms and appearance. Okay, there could be situations with microbial stability. I got to say that's like really rare or never here, but it could be relevant. If you're working with macromolecules, 3D conformation, certainly an enzyme can be affected over time. Appearance, as mentioned before, solubility could change. That's probably tied in with other physical changes such as agglomeration or changes in polymorph, crystallinity, and the like. If you're working with polymers, your molecular size might be affected. So keep an open mind that this is more than just chromatograms and appearance, and that in the world of drug development, it does go beyond drug substances. Here's a list of selected resources that helped for this presentation, and my concluding remarks are a couple of things. First, forced degradation is an essential step in the drug development process, and such studies are required to develop stability indicating methods, and this is quite relevant here at our organization. So with that, I'd like to say thanks for listening, and I would be very happy to handle any questions. Thanks.
Hi, Paul. When would you go about identifying impurities that you saw in a forced degradation study?
Okay, so in forced degradation, which probably occurs early in the project, the idea of IDing impurities may be overkill, maybe. And it becomes quite critical when you need to get into clinical studies where you have to either have qualified impurities, or if they emerge in a real-time stability study, that's when you need to identify them. If you have a stability study going and you're looking at a trend of 1 month and 3 months and stuff is rising to the point of being close to that 0.1% magic number that you need to start thinking about identifying, then I think you need to be seriously concerned that that impurity is going to be even higher, and it's going to become a very urgent matter to get things identified and maybe even qualified with further tox work. Did that answer, Dan?
Yes, thank you.
Sure. Yeah, hi, Suresh. Partially. So the question is, of course, you know, what happens in vivo or in the body is there anything you could get from these forced egg studies to apply there? And the answer is partially yes. I mean, we have to acknowledge that the forced egg conditions are relatively simple. They relate to kind of like external exposures, you know, environmental, maybe formulation issues, and some consideration of the very crude chemistry such as acid in your gut and base in your in small intestine. But when it comes to metabolism, so many other things are at play. There are enzymes degrading. There's liver metabolism, which really is enzymes again, and those will proceed by different mechanisms. There is a whole different separate field of metabolism where drugs fate is tracked as a function of being broken down. And so one analyzes all the body fluids, you know, the blood, the urine, the feces and everything to look for, to track what's going on. Oftentimes radio label is used. Mass spec is certainly a very important tool. And that degradation world is a lot more complex. Thanks again for coming. Okay.